every year.
Oh, I say about 100. You can never learn enough. Ever since we had it patented, we have been improving this concept of the energy-absorbing car body.
But other companies use the concept.
We have never enforced the patent.
So Mercedes gave away a basic safety advance for free?
There are some things in life that are too important not to share.
Get with Natalie Cole on the show that turns somebody into somebody. Big Break, tonight at 11:30.
Dr. Frank Field, Dr. Peter Salgo, and Earl Ubel. New York's only health and science team on Channel 2 News, the first team.
Bieniemy's new high roller on Entertainment Tonight. Today, the Heisman Trophy enters its seventh decade.
1940, the approaching war spreads to the skies over Britain, and its shadow spreads over the Atlantic. In 1940, Michigan's Tom Harmon is the sixth to win the Heisman. In another uniform, Harmon is awarded the Purple Heart.
1950, prosperity beckons. The nuclear family is booming. Ohio State's Vic Janowitz is the natural. The Heisman winner postpones a pro football career to play for the Pittsburgh Pirates.
1960, the young are getting restless. He is our youngest president. And Hitchcock is our most frightening director. In a twist of fate, Heisman winner Joe Bellino of Navy has his 15 minutes of fame, but no more.
And go like this. 1970, fame cannot keep the Beatles together. A disunited States cannot narrow a generation gap. But in the year of the quarterback, Joe Theismann rhymed with Heisman. Still, voters elected Stanford's Jim Plunkett with one of the highest point totals ever.
1980, social activists and quarterbacks are out of fashion. Greed and running backs are in. South Carolina's George Rogers is the ninth consecutive rusher to win the Heisman.
Have a time. 1990, the wall crumbles. Tyson is dropped. The A's collapse. But now, as the falls give way to winter, it is, for the 56th year, Heisman time.
At this moment, the college football world focuses here, Manhattan's financial district, site of the downtown athletic club, where another will join one of the most select fraternities in sports. On this night, the leading candidates have gathered in New York. Virginia senior quarterback Shawn Moore. Notre Dame's junior Raghib Ismail, Colorado senior running back Eric Bieniemy, in Tokyo, Houston junior quarterback David Klingler, and in Honolulu, BYU junior quarterback Ty Detmer. We are on the 13th floor of the Downtown Athletic Club, the location of tonight's Heisman ceremony. Good evening, everyone. Thanks for joining us. I'm Andrea Joyce, along with James Brown, and we are about 20 minutes from the Heisman announcement. And James, there is clearly an element of suspense this year. You know, a lot of people ask me this week, well, gee, do you already know who won? And the fact of the matter is, we don't know until the announcement is made.
And Andrea, I've heard as many different favorites as I've heard conversations, and they run the gamut from what many people consider to be the most exciting football player in college, Raghib Ismail from Notre Dame, and of course, David Klingler of Houston University. And there are some legions of supporters for the dark horse, Shawn Moore, the University of Virginia. Eric Bieniemy is one player that the pro scouts really like. They like his inside running and his outside running.
Okay, of course, we all know that the seeds of Heisman hype are planted in the summertime by advance agents from the schools. This is the official Heisman tie that was distributed on behalf of Ty Detmer back in the summertime. It really is a public relations campaign back then, but the real work begins on the playing fields in early fall.
In an election year when the voters had politicians running scared, the Heisman whistle-stop tour have more plots than politics. Early on, the campaign was stretched out geographically to the far west and mid-east. In Utah, BYU's Ty Detmer quieted Miami's hurricanes with touchdown leaflets, earning important early name recognition. That same day, Virginia took Clemson down, with Shawn Moore's platform promising a farewell to mediocrity. By early October, some Heisman candidates were already compromised. USC's Todd Marinovich was slumping as a sophomore. Never a front runner, Texas A&M's Darren Lewis was out of the running, bumped early against LSU. When Detmer stumbled briefly, intercepted often in an upset loss to Oregon, Virginia's Moore vaulted to the head of the pack, at least until late October. That's when Miami's Craig Erickson saw his faltering chances extinguished because we were all dazzled by the Rockets' flare. And once again in South Bend, Heisman talk was hot. By November, all the candidates with a chance had emerged. For a while, it seemed Houston had a winning strategy again, as David Klingler proved more than able, succeeding Heisman winner Andre Ware. And we took notice of two running backs. There was Colorado's Stampede of One, Eric Bieniemy. Out west, wondering why Washington was suddenly number two in the polls, one reason was steady Greg Lewis. But Washington and Lewis could not hold fast, and others dropped from the campaign trail as well. The Georgia Tech game could have been Shawn Moore's high water mark, but it was his Watergate. And when David Klingler went on to sling 11 touchdown passes against Division I AA Eastern Washington, the landslide was little appreciated.
And we are joined live in Tokyo now by Houston quarterback David Klingler. David, you had a terrific game last night against Arizona State. 7 touchdown passes, 54 for the season. What an incredible year you've had. I want to ask you, though, go back a little bit to the Eastern Washington game. Some folks suggested that you were a little too good for your own good, if that's possible. What did you think about that?
All I can do is just go out and do my job and just play as hard as I can play as long as I'm in there, and that's all you can ask for from a quarterback.
David, I think a lot of people would be surprised to know actually how close you really grew up to football, and here's the explanation. As a kid in Ohio, if David wanted to see his future, all he had to do was look across the street at the Wilson Football Factory. There he could learn the insides of footballs from his grandmother. Making footballs for the last 6 decades, Betty also has 2 grandsons in the game, Heisman candidate David and his Houston backup Jimmy, but she says she's not responsible for all the balls they throw.
If David throws an interception, I didn't have anything to do with that ball. Or if they fumble the ball, I didn't have anything to do with that ball. If he throws a good pass, then Grandma made that ball.
David, if that's true, your grandmother must have been awfully busy this season. But I'm curious, when you're out there on the field, do you have any idea which of those footballs she made?
No, not really. They're all the same to me. I just throw them and let receivers catch them.
Still, I think that your grandmother will probably get some calls from some up-and-coming quarterbacks. David, congratulations on a terrific season. Good to see you again. All right, David Klingler,
thank
of course,
you,
spent most of his young life in Houston, and he stayed home to play football. But another Heisman candidate left Texas, called to a place of rugged beauty where the pass is king, JB.
All right, Andrew, and of course, there are quite a few passes over the state of Utah. But you know, Ty Detmer was raised in San Antonio, Texas. He sat down with his family as a senior in high school to map out the schools he thought he would like to visit, fell in love with the school he made on his first trip, and that, of course, was BYU. Now, he's about to complete what may be the most prolific passing season in college history. Ty now joins us live from Honolulu, where the Cougars are about to play Hawaii a little later on tonight. And Ty, over the past few days, there's been quite a bit written about how you've taken the covers off of your feelings. You said you want this trophy badly. What's fueling that hunger?
Well, you know, I think we've had a great season, and, you know, there's no reason that we shouldn't have one here. We've had great quarterbacks in the past, and none of them have ever won it, and I think it's about time BYU's won one.
Ty, you mentioned those great quarterbacks in the past, Jim McMahon, Steve Young, Robbie Bosco, Mark Wilson. Why do you think none of the quarterbacks have won the Heisman?
I really don't know. Maybe playing in Utah, Western Athletic Conference. I think the conference now is becoming more prominent, and maybe it's time we get one.
Well, certainly you've helped to make it a bit more prominent, and a man who had a major hand in helping you to prominence is your father, who also was your high school coach. He joins us now from Kingsville, Texas, where he's about to play in the quarterfinal action of state championship play in Texas. And, Sonny, let me ask you, what situation or game do you remember of Ty's in high school that told you he was ready for the next level of play?
Well, he had a lot of great games in his senior year. He played a game right at the end of the year, last game, in fact, and threw for 554 yards, and he called all of his own plays in the game. And he really had a good knowledge of the game, and that was a great experience and very memorable to watch.
And I'm sure you have an encouraging word for him, so why don't we give you that opportunity to talk to Ty now?
Well, we've been rooting for you the whole time, and I know you've done enough to win it, and just the best of luck. And you know, you've gone against a lot of great players this year. The rest of them have really put up some numbers and put up some exciting games, and you have too. And we just, you know who we're rooting for. We're rooting for you, Ty.
No bias there indeed. But good luck to the both of you later on tonight for Sonny and in about 15 more minutes for Ty. When we come back with more of the Heisman Award show from the Downtown Athletic Club, we'll look back at an all-purpose wonder from another age, Michigan's Tom Harmon. And we'll talk with the other invitees, Colorado's Eric Bieniemy, Shawn Moore, and Notre Dame's Raghib Ismail.
The 1990 Heisman Trophy Award is sponsored by the Eastman Kodak Company, makers of Kodacolor Gold Film, the Kodak Color Watch System, and the new Kodak Star 35 camera.
It was right after Christmas, that wonderful time when folks drop their film off where they see the sign. With Color Watch, pictures soon will appear with great color up front and Kodak paper back here. Great memories develop when this seals what you see. Without it, bah, humbug, who knows what they'll be. So bring your film to this seal when the holidays end for happy Color Watch memories again and again.
On every trip you take in a Chevrolet, hundreds of hours and millions of dollars have been spent to help make it a safer one. In fact, there are more MDs and PhDs working for your safety than any other car company in the world. So if this looks like an uneventful trip, we worked hard to make it that way. Mile after mile, more people are winning with
the heartbeat of America. That's today's Chevrolet.
I want to fly in business class. My company only pays for coach, so I fly business class for the price of coach. It's called beating the system. Of course, you can't do it on just any airline.
Now till December 15th, when you buy an unrestricted domestic coach ticket on TWA, you can reserve a confirmed seat in our business class for the price of coach.
You pay for coach, you sit in business class, and it isn't even your birthday.
TWA's business class. We did it first, we do it better.
Welcome back to the Heisman Room, and with us tonight, three Heisman winners from three different eras. Larry Kelly of Yale, 1936, Howard Hopalong Cassidy, Ohio State, 1955, and one of four Southern Cal Heisman winners, Charles White, 1979. Gentlemen, nice to see you all. And joining us right now is the chairman of the Heisman Committee, Dennis Leahy. This is not a one-day event. I know that a lot of the former Heisman winners participate in the Heisman process throughout the year. Why don't you tell us about that?
Oh, yeah. They create their own fraternity and represented with a liaison to the committee and the club. Currently, the liaison is Larry Kelly, 1936 winner out of Yale. We've had many active past winners. And, of course, we've had Tom Harmon for many years, our Far West representative. And with his passing, he's sorely missed by the club.
You mentioned Tom Harmon, and there certainly, outside of Bo Schembechler, probably isn't anyone more famous at the University of Michigan than Tom Harmon. And James Brown has that story now, JB.
All right, Andrea, and I'm sure the people who knew Tom Harmon will probably bring smiles to their faces as well as tears of joy when they see this piece. But you know, when Tom Harmon passed earlier this year, it was more than just the University of Michigan fans who lost someone dear. We all did. Tom transcended the game, and he played and lived with a style and verve all his own.
Unquestionably, Tom Harmon was the greatest football player that Michigan has ever produced, and probably one of the greatest players ever in college football.
The great thing about Tom was not, I suppose there have been better runners, there have been better passers, there have been better punters, but there's never been anybody that could combine all of those things.
A truly gifted athlete, Thomas Dudley Harmon was raised in Gary, Indiana, the youngest of six children. He was a three-sport star arriving at Michigan and made a sudden impact. The campus talking about his 95-yard punt return in the first practice. In the 1940 Heisman season, Harmon celebrated his 21st birthday with an untouchable performance against Cal.
Tom, on his fifth or sixth touchdown, was running clear of everybody, and this drunk came out of the stand and took a stab at Tom, and Tom straight armed him and went into the end zone. And when they arrested the fella, he said that he'd watched the other clowns trying to tackle him all day, and he said, "I knew I could do just as well."
Having raised the game to a new level, Harmon was the country's most celebrated athlete, concluding his collegiate career as the overwhelming choice of the Heisman voters. But war soon followed, and Harmon was confronted by life and death challenges. Reported missing in an air crash over North Africa, he somehow survived a week in the jungle. Only months later, over China, he was thought to be missing again. But Harmon led a life of miracles. When he came home, the saving parachute was presented to his fiancée, actress Elise Knox.
"Well, it has a few bullet holes in it, but I don't think that'll bother anything."
The bride wore a wedding gown made from the silk of the bullet-ridden parachute. Three kids followed, Chris, Kelly, and Mark. And though Tom would distinguish himself as a broadcaster, he was never far from the days when Old 98 captivated the nation.
Of course, the number 98 was everywhere. It was in our address, it was in our phone number, it was later in his license plate. But only when I saw the films, the old films of him running, did I realize how really great he was.
I think it came to life for me with meaning when my mother painted a portrait in oil of my father at his last football game, the last game he played, and he was standing there in this stance that I remember him with, those legs and his hands on his hips. And, you know, we miss you.
Michigan football is a long-running success story, but believe it or not, Tom Harmon is the school's only player to win the Heisman. And right now, Andrea Joyce is standing by with the guy who's hoping to become his school's first Heisman winner. Andrea?
That's right, JB. Virginia quarterback Shawn Moore would be the first Heisman winner from his school, but already he is the first Atlantic Coast Conference player ever to be invited to this ceremony. And Shawn, I know that this has been a season of dramatic highs and lows for you. You're here tonight to be honored as a Heisman candidate, and yet late in the season, your team slumped and you injured your thumb. Are you here tonight with mixed feelings?
Well, I think we really got off to a good start this year, and you know, due to injuries in the month of November, we've really had a tough time, and I really feel fortunate to be able to attend ceremonies like this. I feel honored to be here, and you know, it's just a great feeling to be here with so many great people.
Obviously, with this on your hand, you can't work out completely, but I understand this afternoon you did get a chance to work out here at the Downtown Athletic Club with Raghib Ismail, and here you guys are. It looks like you were having a little bit of a contest here. Was this a duel?
Yeah, I told Raghib that you know, I outlasted him even with one hand on the bicycle, and turned out he won.
All right, Shawn, congratulations on a terrific season, and take care of that hand. A lot of folks will be looking for you on New Year's Day.
Thanks a lot.
Okay, and of course, Shawn did lead his team to a number one ranking earlier in this season. JB, you're with the guy who has Colorado on top right now.
As a matter of fact, he helped them climb to the number one position about 3 weeks ago. He holds 18 school records, and I guess, Eric Bieniemy, if there was a headline to your career at Colorado, it would be perseverance, overcoming adversity. You were injured your sophomore and junior seasons, had fumbleitis this year against Nebraska with five, but did score four touchdowns in the fourth quarter. What kept you going?
Well, I think the determination of me and myself and being a part of a great football team, you know, not to fail, got me through. You know, it's just like you said, perseverance always make a person a better person.
I understand that you were a pretty hyper young man on the sidelines, chomping at the bit to get back in. Where did that come from, all that energy? Eating too many candy bars or what?
Nah, I have a mother that just comes at me and gripes at me all the time, so I like to gripe back at her, so I think I got that from her.
Well, you talk about a nice-looking mom, and she's here with him, and talk about an attractive duo. Andrea Joyce is standing by with an attractive duo as well. Andrea?
Oh, that's right, JB, and the son is regarded as the most dangerous player in college football, a returner, receiver, and rusher. He's a touchdown threat every time he touches the ball, Notre Dame's Raghib Ismail. And last year, you watched the Heisman ceremony on television with a bunch of your friends, and you told me when you came in 10th, they really gave you a bad time. Are they treating you any better this year?
It still razz me a little bit, but it's much better than it was last year.
I know you're very uncomfortable with all of the publicity and all of the attention, but you do have an impressive list of admirers, and here's what they have to say about you.
I've been doing Notre Dame football now for over 15 years, and I've seen a lot of great football players come through the university. And in my lifetime, what I've seen in Notre Dame, there's never been a better football player than the Rocket.
Now, he's a great player. I mean, he's everything you want from a big-name player.
I think the Rocket, in the last 2 years, has bounced me out of my chair on four or five different occasions. It was so, so exciting.
Now, there's a lot of speculation this year, Rocket, that Notre Dame coach Lou Holtz will not be back next season to coach the Fighting Irish. If he doesn't come back, are you going to return for your senior year?
With or without Coach Holtz, I'll be at University of Notre Dame next year.
All right, you stuck to your guns. You said that earlier. Okay, well, Rocket has been waiting patiently. JB, you have been patient as well. And when we come back at the Downtown Athletic Club, the announcement, the 56th winner of the Heisman Trophy.
Deserve Kodak film.
There they are, the five Heisman candidates, one to be the 1990 Heisman winner. We should take this opportunity now to review the selection process. It is based on points, not votes. A first place vote is worth 3 points, second place 2 points, third place 1 point. There are 917 voters comprised of selected media and past Heisman winners, and they are divided into six regions, each region with 145 voters, not counting the 47 past Heisman winners. And now for the announcement, let's go to Peter Lambos, president of the Downtown Athletic Club.
For the 56th time, since Jay Berwanger won the award in 1935, it is the special privilege of the Downtown Athletic Club and its membership composed of thousands of men and women resident throughout these United States to join me in letting the country know the name of this year's greatest football player, the winner of the 1990 Heisman Award, whose name is Ty Detmer. Ty Detmer of BYU. Ty Detmer.
All right, Ty, can you hear me? Well, I tell you, I hear an awful lot of noise there. Ty, let me ask, again, I mentioned... All right, Ty, can you hear me now?
I can.
All right, Ty, you had mentioned that you really wanted this award badly. You couldn't sleep. You were having dreams about it. Does the reality of it feel as good as the dreams you were having?
It does. I'm ready to go to New York.
Ty, we've talked again about the long line of quarterbacks who were unsuccessful. What do you think helped to put you over the hump this year to win it?
Well, I think they kind of set the way for us. They, had great seasons in the past, and they just kind of aided at everything our team has done this year, and that they've set the tone for us and got the recognition that started everything off, and now it's finally coming true for BYU and all of Utah.
All right, Ty, a consistently impressive season, and congratulations. And right now, let's go back over to Andrea Joyce.
Well, the weather looks nice there, doesn't it? When we come back, we will look at the final results, and we'll examine how the voting broke down in the six regions as the Heisman Award show continues live from the Downtown Athletic Club on CBS.
There I was, about to make my theatrical debut. My parents waited, my teacher prodded, my sister pointed. Then I made my big entrance.
This Christmas, give the new Kodak Star 35 camera and capture all your holiday memories.
For the grand finale, I brought the house down.
Catch a Kodak Star this Christmas.
What would it take to get you to change from Advil or Tylenol? How about something new from Bayer? New Bayer Plus with Stomach Guard. It's got it all. Bayer Plus has Bayer Aspirin for powerful pain relief. Bang back headaches, muscle aches, and minor arthritis pain. And New Bayer Plus has more. Stomach Guard to help prevent stomach upset. And it's not an aspirin substitute. So bang pain back with a wonder drug that's got it all. New Bayer Plus.
They say the one on top has all the power. Which could be why more truck owners switched to Chevy last year than to any other truck. The top standard horsepower and the top available horsepower, our 454 SS, helped make Chevrolet America's favorite half-ton pickup. For power at the top, more people are winning with. Heartbeat of America, today's
truck is Chevrolet. Ty Detmer of Brigham Young University, and you see the reaction with his father, Sonny Detmer.
And you know, there had been talk all week long about how close this race might come down to, but after all, it wasn't that close after all. Ty Detmer with 1,482 points. Raghib Ismail came in second with 1,177 points. Eric Bieniemy, there you see, in third. And JB, your final thoughts from this afternoon.
Well, you know, Andrea, this is my fourth Heisman Award ceremony, and I think it's become pretty clear that this really isn't an individual honor, but one that the winners really share with their families and their teammates.
Okay, and of course, for the winner, it all begins with a wish. And on this day, Ty Detmer finds that the wishing comes true.
But I see your true colors shining through. I see your true
Me and Ty used to have fights pretty often, and I get a golf club after him one time, and he closed the door in my face, so I hit the door with the golf club, and then my dad came home, and we got in trouble, and we had to earn the money that summer to pay for a new door.
When he was growing up, we had a lot of kids in the neighborhood. He was usually the younger one, smaller one, and so he had to compete. He had to be a little tough, and they got into it a lot of times, and I'd want to go out and referee and make sure my son got the right, you know, treatment, but Sonny'd say, leave him alone. He's got to fight his own battles.
Well, everybody always talks about his toughness. You know, you hear him allude to it on TV, how tough he is. He can take a leg. He stands in and holds the ball to the last minute and then lets it go, and I think concentration leads to toughness.
Just friendly to everybody, you know, on the ball club. I've never had a quarterback that you know, that the defense is like so well. And generally, those guys don't like quarterbacks.
Oh, I guess probably the best way to sum that up would be that when I grow up, I'd like to be like Ty.
The first BYU player ever to win the Heisman Award, the first Heisman winner of the new decade, and a very proud moment indeed for Ty Detmer's family as well. And we would like to offer our congratulations to all of the candidates here this evening, and we will say goodbye from New York.
The airline that brings you 10 countries across Asia and the Pacific now bridges the Atlantic to Europe. Come fly the airline that spans more than half the world. United. Come fly the friendly skies.
is CBS.
Coming up on Channel 2 News Saturday, paying more at the pump. The price of gasoline goes up across the country, but it's not because of the Middle East crisis. Plus, local reservists say goodbye and head for a mission to the Mideast. Also tonight, Saddam Hussein gives the go-ahead for talks, but there's one condition. And forget about those high-tech mountain bikes. Maury Alter will have some bikes that will bring back memories. Rock with the Heisman Trophy pick and Craig's mixed weather forecast next.
Thinking about an Alfa Romeo? Think about two, the 164 and the Spider. One, a 5-passenger, 140-mile-an-hour luxury sedan. The other, a 5-speed, top-down, hands-on sports car. Why think about both? Because for what you probably thought you'd pay for one, you could have two. For the test drive of your life, see the yellow pages for an Alfa dealer near you.
Where can you jam with the biggest names in the business and the hottest new acts from around the country? Pump It Up every week with host Natalie Cole and her special guests, including Regina Bell, In Vogue, and Tony. Then get busy with the stars of tomorrow slamming for $100,000 on the show that makes somebody big break. Tonight at 11:30 on Channel 2. Match Wits with the Quiz Kids, weekdays at 9:30.
Now, Reggie Harris, Dana Tyler, Brock Roach with sports, and Craig Allen with weather. The first team. This is Channel 2 News, Saturday.
Good evening, I'm Reggie Harris. Dana Tyler has tonight off. Here's what's happening. You may have noticed that prices at the gasoline pump are up by a nickel across the nation tonight. We've been paying more to fill up our tanks ever since trouble started in the Middle East. But as J.J. Gonzalez reports, the federal government is doing the financial squeezing this time.
Gas prices have been on the rise for the last few months, as high as 27 cents in the metropolitan area. Most oil companies finger Saddam Hussein's takeover of Kuwait as the cause. But today the price went up 5 cents more, and you couldn't blame anybody but the federal government.
What'd you pay yesterday?
It was $1.49 a gallon.
And today?
It's $1.54.
How's that going to affect you?
I think it's going to affect everybody, the consumers.
In the past, federal gas tax revenues have been earmarked for transportation programs and road work. But this time, half of the 5 cent increase is going to reduce the federal deficit. It's expected to add $5 billion a year to the Treasury. The hardest hit will be those with big cars who have low gas mileage. Some are just taking the new tax in stride.
I like a big car. I'm going to keep my car. I like the room. I like the protection. And I'll just have to earn more money.
On New Jersey's Route 4, where there's a lot of competition for customers, the tax hike won't necessarily be passed on to the consumer. Betsy Geslin raised her prices only 4 cents on special and super unleaded gas, absorbed a penny loss.
If you're not competitive with the marketplace, you will not sell the product. So therefore, again, we took it on the chin, and we're going to see how our volume is at these particular prices.
Some take advantage of these price wars. Many cross the border from New York City.
I come over the bridge, and I save a nickel a gallon. Oh, well, not a nickel, maybe more like a dime.
On the other side of the Hudson River, Manhattan motorists are acutely aware of the hike. The governor even issued a price gouging alert, telling motorists to report any hikes of more than 5 cents per gallon on gas prices here.
Of course, I'm aware of that. Usually the price differs between Brooklyn and Manhattan, about 10 cents a gallon. So this is about the right price.
Many motorists are doubly put out because the new taxes came just a few months after the states raised their own gasoline taxes. Money needed for mass transit. J.J. Gonzalez, Channel 2 News.
And New York State is asking anyone who spots gas price gouging to report it to the Consumer Protection Board. The hotline number is 212-587-4482. Hundreds of Army reservists said their goodbyes to loved ones today at Fort Totten in Queens. Channel 2's Lisa Castleman was there as they headed off for a tour of duty in the Persian Gulf.
We ask, O Lord, that you take care of them.
If it's ever possible for one event, one moment, to stir mixed emotions, this troop deployment at Fort Totten was it. There was so much pride, even in the youngest children, eager to follow in Daddy's footsteps. and so much pain in nearly everyone's eyes as the 301st support group gathered for one last goodbye.
The stability of the world is at stake. Let nobody tell you that anything else is what we're dealing with. Look on yourselves as the Army of the United States has always looked on themselves as the greatest insurers of peace and stability in the world.
These troops will handle maintenance, kitchen, and bath supplies for other units in the desert. With this deployment, there are now 1,000 New York area reservists actively involved in Operation Desert Shield. And this group, unlike most others, has already trained in the desert.
General Donahue told his troops that he's encouraged by the president's most recent effort to reach a diplomatic solution to the crisis. But if it should come to war, he says, he's confident that his soldiers will be ready.
But for families, it seemed there was no way to be ready.
So I'm scared, but I have faith he's gonna come back and everything is gonna be all right. Yeah. For sure, that's gonna be like that.
I'm dying. I'm from Baton Rouge, and I came up here to see him leave. It was a very big shock.
Is that your brother?
No, it's my fiance.
Good luck to you, all right?
Thank you, sir.
With the final words of encouragement came a final command. When your loved ones write, said the general, they'll be worried about you. Take a moment, pick up a pen, and write back. They'll need the mail as much as you do. At Fort Totten, Lisa Castleman, Channel 2 News.
The Iraqi news agency said today Saddam Hussein accepts the U.S. offer for talks on the Persian Gulf crisis, but with a key string attached. The Iraqi statement says talks must include the Arab-Israeli conflict, a linkage the U.S. has previously rejected. As President Bush met with his aides at Camp David today, the White House said is still waiting for Saddam's official response to the offer to send Secretary of State James Baker to Baghdad. In Iraq, tens of thousands of Iraqis turned out today to protest this week's United Nations resolution giving Saddam until January 15th to pull out of Kuwait. Syria's defense minister today said his country is prepared to send 500,000 troops to the Gulf. There are now 4,000 Syrian troops among Gulf forces. And the Pentagon says a U.S. airman killed in a vehicle accident became the 50th American to die since U.S. troops were sent to Saudi Arabia in August. There's a warrant out tonight for the arrest of former East German leader Erich Honecker. It comes after the discovery of documents showing Honecker ordered border guards to shoot and kill East Germans trying to cross the Berlin Wall. Authorities are said to be on their way to a military hospital tonight to arrest him. He was overthrown a year ago during a peaceful revolution that led to German unification. In New Jersey, an elementary school principal is charged tonight with sexually assaulting an 11-year-old boy and endangering the welfare of two other boys. The alleged victims are students at the Gilbert Avenue Elementary School in Elmwood Park. 48-year-old Samuel Brosigliano, principal there for 10 years, is free tonight on $7,500 bail. Police say a search of the principal's house turned up boxes of photos and videotape of naked young boys, some pictures taken in Brosigliano's school office. If convicted, he faces 25 years in jail. Mayor David Dinkins met with City Council Speaker Peter Vallone this afternoon, hoping to reach agreement on a new crime-fighting package. The council wants to scale back the mayor's plan to hire 9,600 new cops over the next 4 years.
My major concern is that there be an appropriate balance if we are obliged to scale down our program so that it still is cops and kids. Because if we don't have preventive measures in there, we will still continue to waste young lives, to say nothing of the violence they will do to the rest of us.
The state legislature has to okay tax increases to pay for part of the plan, but lawmakers say they won't talk about the proposal until Dinkins and Vallone reach agreement. A possible strike by private sanitation workers could turn New York into a real mess. The workers' contract expired at midnight. They collect garbage in New York City and surrounding suburbs. If they walk out, they leave behind garbage from 40% of the city's businesses, including hotels, restaurants, and commercial companies. A strike vote is scheduled for tomorrow morning. Well, we have a lot more still ahead, including a day of deliberations as jurors in the second Central Park jogger case try to reach a decision. Plus, a day without art, remembering artists who lost their lives to